Good evening. My name is Karen Cooney. I'm the director of the Viralist Center for Art and Politics here at the New School, and I'm delighted to welcome you to the New School. Less than a month ago, we presented a day-long screening of films examining the Israeli-Palestinian conflict and its articulations in film under the title United States of Palestine, Israel, Here and Elsewhere. The program was curated by our current fellow, Joshua Simon, and consisted of historical footage, documentary and artistic films brought together under the rubric of quote-unquote solutions after the title of a book edited by Simon. That was 1 week before Palestinian President Abbas applied to the United Nations for membership of Palestine. Tonight, we are honored to present to you a related event, Israeli and Palestinian Cinema, Shaping Memory and Imagining the Future, celebrating the new edition of the seminal book, Israeli Cinema, East, West, and the Politics of Representation by Ella Shohat. The book caused an uproar when it was first published in 1989 in Hebrew. It analyzed in plain language the role of film in the construction of nationalism. Why do we celebrate a book that first appeared in 1989? Because it has been significantly expanded on with an extensive, invaluable postscript. And because in the current political situation, it might be particularly revealing to examine how one country's existence can be or has been conditioned on the denial of another. My sincere thanks go to Ella Shohat, whose groundbreaking scholarship we're celebrating tonight. Deep thanks also to Rasha Salti, an independent curator, writer, and author, whose own program, Experimentation in Arab Cinema from 1960 to Now, will be open and be presented next week at the Museum of Modern Art. The conversation between the two of them will be interspersed by four brief film clips selected by Shohat and listed in your program. Thanks are also due to Arte East, a trusted and long-term collaborator for us. But before we begin, it gives me particular pleasure to ask a colleague of mine, Sumita Chakravarti, to introduce Ella Shohat. Sumita Chakravarti is the Associate Dean, School of Media Studies at the New School, at the New School for Social Engagement, a film scholar and writer in her own right, and as we will hear, a long-term admirer of Shohat. Thank you all very much for coming. Sumita, please.
Thank you. I wrote down my comments so I could, I wouldn't take too much time, so please bear with me, but this is really a very special occasion for me. So it is my great privilege to welcome Professor Ella Shohat to the New School this evening and to mark the 20th anniversary of her pioneering book. I have known Ella for upwards of that time and followed with great admiration her passionate devotion to what she has undertaken as a lifelong task, namely deconstructing the politics of representation and underscoring the importance of connecting such representations to politics in general. Thus, she embodies the very spirit underlying the Viralist Center of Art and Politics, and betokens its quintessential guest. I want to only briefly touch on the highlights of Ella's book, since I'm sure she has much to tell us about its career over the years. But first, I want to dwell on what Ella and her work have meant to me personally. There are some chapters of one's life the full significance of which becomes apparent to us only years later, but which come to assume the character of turning points. My meeting with Ella is one such chapter in my intellectual growth and career. As a doctoral student relocating from the Midwest to the New York region in the mid-1980s, I was looking for some guidance and fellowship that would make the task of writing a dissertation less daunting. I found it through a lecture series on third world film organized by Professor Robert Stamm of NYU's Cinema Studies Department. I first met Ella there, and I was simultaneously exposed to a range of national cinemas. Ella spoke on Egyptian cinema, Bob on Brazilian cinema. I presented my work on Indian cinema, and there were papers on Filipino, Cuban, and Mexican cinema. Collectively, it seemed we explored and critiqued paradigms of the national, put that away, and the colonial in an era when post-colonial studies had not quite been invented. After Ella's book came out, she helped me find a publisher for mine, among many other acts of friendship and intellectual sharing. Her many instances of co-authorship show how strongly she believes in dialogue on the most challenging topics. Let me highlight for those who are not in cinema studies a few of the themes that have driven Ella's engaged scholarship. First, there is the project of de-orientalizing the Orient. Building on the influential work of Edward Said, Ella broadened the scope of his critique by turning to the popular form of cinema and to its ways of structuring relations of power. Israeli cinema is therefore a lens into the cinematic soul of Israel-Palestine. But it is also a fascinating history of a regional cinema, no doubt the first of its kind, and the book painstakingly maps out the genres, motifs, and movements of this cinema. For the cultural outsider, when the book first appeared, a rich cast of characters, texts, and vocabularies was at hand. As we learnt of the differences between the European origin Ashkenazi Jews and the Oriental Sephardi Jews, Bureka films, which were sentimental comedies and melodramas, the Sabra as signifier, the Sabra I learnt is a cactus plant that grows in the Middle East, and a host of other terms like this. For instance, it was a revelation to me that the Bureka film had been influenced by a famous Indian film called Shri 420 and contained snatches of a very popular song that Ella sang for my benefit. Each chapter of Ella's book is filled with revelations of this kind. Through dozens of film examples, the book builds up a complex picture of Israeli cinema and Israeli-Arab relations. The second theme that has been useful to me in my own teaching and research is the idea of relationality. Focusing on the concept of ethnicity, one that is central to American culture's self-understanding, Ella's work has shown the codependence of ethnic relations and the ways in which films organize them. In a fascinating essay, which I have used repeatedly in my classes, called Ethnicities in Relation, and which formed a chapter in the award-winning text Unthinking Eurocentrism, co-written by Ella and Professor Robert Stamm, she noted that, and I quote, "In a multi-ethnic society, communities are necessarily implicated economically, historically, politically, and culturally in one another, subjected to permeable boundaries of identity." She taught my students how to think about relationality in very productive ways. The third, and to my mind, the most important theme is that of empowerment and social change, and the role of art and culture in bringing about such change. Ella is one of those rare scholars in whose work spirited indictment of prejudice, oppression, and inequality is matched by optimism regarding the value of critique and the necessity of putting it into practice. In her work on gender, race, and ethnicity, on global politics, on the fraught history of East-West relationships, and on media and multiculturalism, she has shown herself to be alert to all kinds of biases, but also to moments of grace and opportunities for connection. It is these themes and emphases that I think make Ella's work uniquely suited to the new school and its students. Those of us who are teachers and scholars understand that teaching the right values through the power of critical thinking, and especially the straddling of academic rigor and social purpose, is never an easy task. Students are often impatient to get involved, to think that they can instinctively recognize the right thing or the right cause without the often long and arduous process of reading difficult texts, doing archival research to understand the movements of history, and knowing how to interpret an increasingly complex world. When such situations arise, I always think of Ella and draw inspiration from her resolute commitment to both aspects of a common endeavor. Like all pioneering works, the book for which we are here this evening remains relevant and thought-provoking, for the Israeli-Palestinian issue is as urgent today as it was when Israeli cinema addressed it years ago. I'm not qualified to comment on the impact books such as Ella's may have had in Palestinian self-perception and filmmaking, so I look forward to the discussion to follow and to be brought up to date on what is a fascinating and complex realm of cinema. Please extend a very warm welcome to Professor Ella Shohat and to Rasha Salti. Thank you.
I also have my story with Ella. But I would like to begin by thanking everybody for coming tonight and coming so many. I would like to thank Karen Kuoni and Annie Shaw for their patience with me and my tribulations, and Ella and everybody else that worked on making this event possible. I am a graduate of this institution when it was called the Graduate Faculty. So I'm very happy to be, this is my first public event here, so I'm very happy to be here. I'm mostly happy to be at the Veralist Center. I, as a film programmer and a curator who has sort of come into her own in New York City, the Veralist Center has always been a place that I've really admired tremendously, found extremely interesting, and it's I don't regret many things for leaving New York and moving to Beirut, except one of the things that I miss is missing the, or one of the things I regret is missing the programs of the Veralist Center. I also want to thank RT East for supporting their retired directors and programmers and staff. Today's event is very meaningful to me because I am having a conversation with one of the women and one of the scholars that have really marked me, almost changed my life. I did not know Ella Shohat. When I was 18 years old, somebody thought they could seduce me by offering me unthinking Eurocentrism. I kept the book. I didn't go to dinner. So, but I met Ella in 1996. I was on a visit to New York, and we were talking about a project around Edward Said in Beirut. And when arranging for the meeting, I asked her what did she want for me to bring to her from Beirut, and she said photographs of the Jewish cemetery. The Jewish cemetery, it just so happened that when I was a very young child, I grew up next to the Jewish cemetery. So it's, my grandparents' house is in ruins. So there were two ruins next to each other. I didn't trust myself with photography. I asked a very good photographer, Akram Zaatari, to take the photographs. And I came to New York, and we sat in a cafe in the West Village, and I handed over the photos. And I think a lifelong friendship was forged then. When she asked me to bring the photos of the Jewish cemetery, it was the first moment of awakening for me to this tragic absence in our Arab cities, in our Arab countries. I began to develop an interest in our Jewish communities, our Arab Jews who had left. Their cemeteries were still there. Their synagogues were still there. Sometimes they're in a good shape, like in Cairo. Sometimes they're destroyed, like in Beirut, although the main synagogue has been restored recently. This tremendous tragic absence is an open wound. And this open wound, at least my generation, I have decided to carry it, to face it, to address it. One of my dreams is not only to return to Palestine, but to bring back our Jews. It's romantic and simplifying, but Ella's work influenced me to the extent that when I joined the New School to do my master's program, I did it on the Israeli Black Panthers movement. Who knew the Black Panthers existed in Israel? It's the story of the Mizrahim, the Arab Jews in Israel. And it was in a way for me to give back all that she had given to me as a friend, as a scholar. So that's my story with Ella. We start with the book. So the book is called Israeli Cinema, and people see Israeli cinema because the letters are large. However, it's all in the subtitle. And the title Israeli Cinema is part of the controversy that has accompanied the book. The subtitle, East/West and the Politics of Representation, is transparent about the mission and the ambition of the book. It was her PhD doctoral thesis, completed in 1986, and it became a book in 1989. Until now, the book, it's a very interesting book because it's canonical of the fate of vanguard works. It is all about post-colonial studies, but it preceded the establishment of post-colonial studies. It is a book about the Middle East, so it falls within this area studies. At the same time, it talks about culture and cinema, relationality. It addresses a whole set of productions and sites of production of images and manifestation of power relations that area studies usually don't like to look at. The postscript was long overdue, and the reissue of the book is like a new gift. We have had our discussions, and we would like to begin. We're going to structure this conversation along film clips that will basically visit key issues in the book and in the postscript that remain relevant. The ambition of the book is to examine the space of cinema. Israeli cinema is a national cinema. And so the idea is to explore, deconstruct cinema as a national space. The first question that arises with Israeli cinema is, what is included in Israeli cinema? How do we write the story of the space, of that imagined space? Is it possible to write it without Palestine? That's the first question. And when you deconstruct a national cinema, you're deconstructing a national paradigm, but Israel is also a colonial state. So there was one of the most complicated, and that is what made the book vanguard, is the deconstruction of nationalism and colonization. Would you like to say anything before?
Well, first, thank you all. Thank you, Rasha. Thank you, Sumita. Thank you, Karen. And thanks, the New School, for this incredible, warm welcome. I'm extremely moved. There is always this thing about first works and about late works too, but I hope this is, we're only dealing with first works here. And so this is very exciting for me to be here and very moving. I should say that, I'm over 40, I realize that this is over 30 years that I'm here in New York. It's been the place where I've lived most of my life. And in a sense, it's also a product of New York City, even though it is written about the Middle East. And I think when you ask the question about the whole question of, about the issue of what is that space of Israel and Palestine in the cinema, my first response would be to say that it is in many ways a transnational space. It goes beyond, to really think about nations in general, one has to also transcend the idea of the nation. And I think it is something that is often very difficult, particularly in the context of colonial relationship, in the context of power. How do we deconstruct power relationship? How do we deconstruct the idea of institutions in the context where there is dispossession, dislocation of populations, refugees, desire to return? And so it is not simply about the geography Israel-Palestine. It is also about the dislocations that have taken place in the context of war and violence. And so cinema, in many ways, it is impossible to write the story of Israeli cinema without speaking about Palestine and Palestinians. And I think this was really the early project. I mean, I'm not even talking right now about the postscript, but the early project was about understanding the story of Zionism as a movement that started and began in the late 19th century, exactly at the same time that cinema was born, as it were. And it is in a context where population had to be engineered, in a sense, to be moved and dislocated from, as they say, from the four corners of the globe and come to Israel and be part of this new notion of a nation. So it's in many ways, while nationalism can be subjected to many critiques, and there is an ongoing argument about the invention of the nations and how nations are imagined, this is probably one of the extreme cases in which the nation had to be invented literally by bringing people into a particular piece of land, Israel-Palestine. And here, in this context, how can one tell the story of Zionism without the story of Palestine and without incorporating a Palestinian point of view? So I think there was an expectation that with this title, that Israeli cinema would obviously be some kind of a celebration of the idea of Israeli cinema, and it is a celebration of cinema in itself, but it is also a form of deconstructing the idea of the national, and also looking into the anomalous character of the Israeli project as both, yes, it is about creating the nation, but it is also about colonial project toward Palestinians. So this kind of tension was really crucial. And constantly I was addressing the paradoxical elisions of Palestinians. So to write even about cinema in pre-Israel, in Palestine, when diverse, not only propaganda films, but indirect fictional films that were all about generating this idea of the new nation. And it was fascinating that you had location shooting, let's say in the Galilee, and you did see Palestinians in the shots, and yet the titles were The Empty Land. And this incredible idea, how can you show an image in location shooting of Palestinians and yet have a caption called An Empty Land? And I think that tension drove, in a sense, my analysis. I mean, in a sense, you can see it as a kind of a metaphor for the tension in terms of you show or speak about the Arabs, and yet there is a denial of their very existence. And this is kind of, it is not simply that you do not see Arabs, it is not that you do not have Arab characters. If you do have, they must applaud, of course, the civilizing mission. And this is, I think, sort of like if I speak about the early project. But what I could have never imagined is when I finished writing the book or the dissertation in 86, and in a sense called for a more polyphonic kind of cinema that incorporates or moves beyond the idea of the nation, brings on diasporic perspectives, that there would be such a cinema, and a cinema produced by Israelis which does address Palestinian point of view, engages in dialogue with Palestinians, collaborates with Palestinians, whether within Israel or fi dakhil or outside Israel. And so the space, literally, the space of making Palestinian cinema and Israeli cinema, or I prefer to call it in and around Israel-Palestine, because it allowed me in the postscript to speak about the complexity of that idea of making cinema around the question of Israel-Palestine, a cinema that cannot be simply located in one geography, that must address this multiple movements, particularly in this over the past over 20 years, when it's not simply a matter of co-production, it's a matter of people not being able really to live in Israel-Palestine, and then forced, as it were, even if they carry Israeli passports. It is really the liminal zone of Palestinians who are citizens of Israel, or Arab Jews and Mizrahim who do claim that identity, and who are trying to negotiate, and also Jews of European origins who are trying to imagine a different future.
The segues to the it's a beautiful preface to the clip we will see now, a film that you cite often in the postscript. Route 180.
In fact, it is also taken from
the image on the cover of the book is taken from that film. Route 181, Fragments of a Journey in Palestine - Israel, was released in 2004. It is co-directed by Eyal Sivan and Michel Chleifi. Eyal Sivan is Israeli. Michel Chleifi is Israeli, Palestinian.
The two films. They live outside of Israel.
And they both now live. Eyal Sivan has left Israel a few years ago. Michel Chleifi has been living in Belgium for more than two decades. The film is a travelogue along the borders, the many borders within Israel. So the 67 border, the border of Israel, 48 borders. We will see a clip that basically will introduce our discussion of borders, what they mean.
شو قصة هاي الحدود؟ هاي الحدود يا سيدي لما اجوا بال 48 اجى مهندس اردني من الجيش الاردني ومعه حرس ومعه هيك طلعها بخرطة وحطها هون 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 كم حجار وتكون تشيل ابيض لما نوصل بيتنا تكون هون وارضنا هيك البعيد هيك جنبوه هيك كم عاد يحطوا الحد هون جنب البيت ومشوا طيب يا عمي ما بصير هيك هاي ارض لنا يا بتاخذوا الارض مع البيت للاردن يا بتجيبوا البيت والارض مع اسرائيل اما احنا باسرائيل البيت باسرائيل والارض بالاردن ما بصير قال هيك هيك الخطه بتكون انا بمدخلها بعد ما مشى يعني تقول ابعد كيلو عنا انا جيت هديت كل البنايه اللي بناها انا ومن الحدود على الارض الارض ودخلت تبشيد وظبطها عملوا وكبرت الدوله حوالي 20,000 دنم وهذا ثاني يوم ضابط ارتباط اردني وضابط ارتباط يهودي راكبين على خير راكبين ندعى تعي ولد تعي ولد كان وين الحدود؟
المكالوان اللي حدود خفت قلت عرقه قلت بجوز عرقه وهسه بالبحرون قلت له يا سيدي امبارح من هون اجى الضابط والمهندس وعمل هاي الحدود ما حط الخارطة قال لي مزبوط شكرا مزبوط ومحط عليه خلنا البيت مع الأرض
Thank you. The futility of borders.
Exactly. I think this is a fabulous clip just to illustrate the artificiality of borders and that, you know, it really has implication not simply for the ongoing struggle about defining where does Israel begin and where does Palestine begin, but really looking into borders in its multiple ramifications in their literal sense, but also I wanted to think about borders in terms of in terms of cultural identities, and that to think about Israel-Palestine simply as Israelis and Palestinians misses the point about the much cultural interface. There is the question of land and the struggle around it, but there is also the question of how a land was artificially marked and the question of two people living side by side became some kind of part of a war and an ongoing war. At the same time, it showed the absurdity of borders and their demarcation, and that the struggle today to think about one state or two states or binational states goes back to 48 and to the United Nations decision that is still with us, still haunting the present day decision, and that we're still struggling to have for Palestinian to have self-determination. But in terms of identities, when it comes to the cinema, how do we define in terms of border the cinema of Palestinians within the state of Israel? Palestinians who are citizens of Israel. How do we speak about that? And I think this collaboration, for me it was fascinating to have a project that was collaborative between a Euro-Israeli filmmaker, Eyal Sivan, and a Palestinian from Nazareth, who's also a citizen of Israel, Michel Chlefi. And as they travel through this kind of imagined borders, you know, the United Nations partition line from 47, in search of an absurd and non-existent partition line, and the people that they encounter along that imagined border, that we hear oral history, in a sense. And cinema becomes an important vehicle to tell a long-lost history that perhaps simple documents may not be able to tell us. And that has to do also with cinema power as a non-writing. I mean, it incorporates writing, it incorporates music, it's a multi-track medium. But I think the power of cinema, and that's actually coming back to Sumita's introduction, within the context of studying Third World cinema, one of the powerful elements was that cinema could tell stories that for many people who could not read or who could not write, that cinema created some kind of a collective experience that was very empowering. And I think that's why many of us ended up studying cinema, even though some of us came from background of literature, because we felt like it could actually give voice to stories such as the story of partition, the grand narrative of partition, and those whose voice was silenced in and around the partition line.
Cinema as a repository of collective memory and lived experience. The next clip complicates further this notion of the Palestinian Israeli. It's from a film called Since You Left. The film is a documentary. It was released in 2005. It is directed by Mohammed Bakri. Mohammed Bakri is an actor. He is also an Israeli-Palestinian, or Palestinian-Israeli. He comes up very often in the book and in the postscript. For a long time, he embodied the Palestinian in a certain trope, in a certain set of attributes in Israeli films, but also in international films, Hollywood films, etc. He was in Hanakeh, he was in
by Costa Gavras.
Maybe you want to tell an anecdote about Mohammed Bakri, why he's important as an actor as well.
Yeah, I think what's important, I mean, he started sort of like appearing first in he was known to the American in the context of the U.S. with a film by a leftist director called Costa Gavras in a film called Hanake, which was probably the first sympathetic film to the Palestinian struggle, and Mohammed Bakri was cast. He has his origins, actually, in terms of his professional work, actually date back to his work in the Haifa Theater. But he also played in some early Israeli film that tried to cast, unlike earlier films which cast the Mizrahim, the Arab Jews, Jews from Arab countries, to play the role of Arabs in most heroic nationalist films, there was, in the 80s, there was the beginning of a different and a new kind of a politics of casting. And in a film that was actually distributed here at the time, Beyond the Walls, he played a relatively a sympathetic role of a Palestinian. But what was important for me in that story is he wasn't only an actor. He had also a role in shaping the script when he felt that the film did not actually represent the Palestinian prisoners' experience. And so simply to say an actor wouldn't be sufficient for someone who had an important role and in shaping also Israeli cinema. So hence we come once again to this question, where do we draw the line when we say Israeli cinema and Palestinian cinema, when Palestinians had a role in shaping Israeli cinema and also Israeli understanding of Palestinian cinema and creating a new kind of Israeli cinema. So rather than thinking of Israeli filmmakers as simply representing Palestinians, one has to rethink this whole notion and think of Palestinian also helping shape a new kind of Israeli writing.
Since You Left is a film, it's a kind of a tribute to Emil Habibi. And I'm just going to take a minute to tell you about Emil Habibi, because he is really a foundational figure in for Israeli Palestinians, but for Arabs worldwide, but for also for Israeli Palestinians in particular. He died. He was born in 1922, died in 1996. He was a very prominent figure in the Communist Party, and the Communist Party in Israel is a party that included Palestinians and Israelis. So it was one Communist Party, not several. And he founded a newspaper, the Arabic language newspaper, Al-Ittihad. Al-Ittihad was key in providing Palestinian Arabs, Palestinian Israelis, with a voice, with cultural dissemination. It formed so many writers. It was a very important platform. Habibi's contribution is his first novel. It's called The Secret Life of Said the Pessimist. He coined that word, pessimist, from pessimist and optimist. And it underscored the absurdity of the notion of Palestinian Israeli. The book is marvelous. I mean, it's still a very contemporary read. And it tells the story of a bureaucrat, of a Palestinian Israeli bureaucrat. It has a lot of dark and sarcastic humor. I don't think it is possible to read the cinema of Elia Suleiman, or actually anyone coming out of Nazareth trying to be slightly funny, without thinking of the influence of Emil Habibi. The power of the irony and the power of this black humor. So he was a very important figure. So Bakri goes to his grave and talks to him and tells him what has happened since he died.
And in the sequence, sequence you're going to see, it's actually, there is an archival footage of Bakri as a young person speaking with Emil Habibi about some experiences they had. And then there is a cut to that revisit to the cemetery. And the context is, I should just add, that Bakri, despite the fact that he was relatively an accepted figure within Israeli liberal circles. Once he made a documentary called Jenin Jenin after the massacres that took place in Jenin, he became a persona non grata, and especially after his family was somehow accused of being linked to some suicide bombing action. So he was excommunicated, and up to now he suffers and lives with the consequences of that. So for him to, it is in that context that he made this film, Since You Left, Min Yom Marucht, which is a kind of revisiting his relationship with Emil Habibi in homage to Emil.
So this clip and the Peace Optimist and Mohammed Bakri, Ella talked to us about this, the absurdity of the Palestinian Israeli, the tragedy within this absurdity. What is interesting in your postscript is that it's true that Israeli Palestinians and Palestinian Israelis have been making films since the book was published. They have found funding, they have found producers, they have found this, and some films are produced by Israeli funds, and some films are produced by European and sometimes even Arab money. In the past few years, these filmmakers like to call themselves Palestinian only. And as a programmer for Toronto this year, I received a film from a French producer that said the film is produced entirely with Israeli and French money. There's not a single
Palestinian
penny, but it's all in Arabic. And it's by an Israeli director who is of Palestinian origin. They didn't know which territory it should fit into. They sent it to me because ultimately the film speaks Arabic and it's set in Jerusalem.
Yeah, well, this is a fascinating question, I think, for programmers, curators, and writers about cinema and making, you know, I mean, again, we come back once again to the artificiality of borders. And I think even how we conceptualizing studies of cinema under national rubrics, which, again, as I said, must be constructed, deconstructed. The same thing with programming. I would have imagined, I mean, if I were, you know, if we could think new programming, we should think genres, we should think film language, not necessarily
territories,
even if we want to have some territorial focus. I mean, I think it's important at this point, obviously historically, this reclaim for Palestinians within Israel, the term Palestine, and which I think was always there. It's more a question of articulating it or pronouncing it in the public sphere and how it affects cultural work. Because as we can see, this is a very fluid category in terms of funding, but not in terms necessarily of claiming history and identity. And I think sort of like if you want to submit a film for the Oscar, if it comes after the rubric of Palestine, you know, as we know the case with Elise Lehmann, divine intervention, it couldn't have been submitted as Palestine for the simple reason that there is no such country called Palestine. So if you're a Palestinian filmmaker making a film and want to claim that rubric, that becomes obviously an impossibility. So this is sort of like the consequence of those kind of border and nation state definitions. The in terms of languages, I mean, I think the question of language in the cinema plays an important role, both in Israeli cinema and in Palestinian cinema, and in and around those films and in between them. There is really a liminal zone, especially when we speak about alternative critical cinema and those kind of collaboration that we saw. Because the question of citizenship comes to be redefined, the question of nation comes to be redefined, and you have in the cinema, even if not in reality, the cinema imagines the future. It is through the cinema that we Palestinians in Israel can also claim their Palestinian identity in a context where it has been taboo, in the context where their identity has been subjected to policing. The first film, fictional film, to actually address it was Michel Chlefi. It was at the time that I was writing, finishing the dissertation, the book, the dissertation at the time, and I just knew that it was a film in the, and I was incredibly curious when it was
Wedding in Galilee.
Yeah, Wedding in Galilee. Thank you. Yeah, and later on it came out, but this is a film that actually, for the first time, dealt with the history and, in the American context, an unknown history of the fact that Palestinians within the state of Israel, not outside of Israel, not the West Bank, but within the state of Israel, lived under military rule until 1966. So for a film to take that history and and there is a fascinating moment which is highly allegorical, the moment where a Palestinian woman tells a Israeli soldier in this against this backdrop of a wedding in a Palestinian village, if you want to dance, you will have to take off your uniform. So I think what most Palestinian filmmakers have been doing, especially in this genre fictional films, is not simply to speak about oppression and dispossession, but also at the same time to try to imagine a future, and unlike the official Israeli discourse, in fact, to take on board even sometimes the anxieties of European Jews, which I found quite fascinating. In Min Yom Maruh, the film with Mohammed Bakri, there is an incredible sequence where he speaks with his lawyer, Feldman, the lawyer who defends him, who speaks about his own story as a son of Holocaust survivors. So I think from the kind of film that I have seen, Palestinians have made a tremendous effort to actually understand the anxieties and phobias of Israelis. And that is articulated in the cinema. And for me, this has been an incredible moment of dialogue and imagination of the future.
You touched on two key themes in your book, cinema citizenship It's a great notion, especially for a film programmer. So I could give passports and stand at some border and prevent some people from coming into my country. Polyglossia. You call for a polyphonic cinema, a multilingual polyglossia.
Yeah. You just. I think. At the end of the book, the old book before the postscript, I called for that kind of cinema. I recognize some moments in the history of Israeli cinema. For example, a film like The House on Schluss Street, or a film like Light Out of Nowhere, that tried somehow to touch, but there were moments. And I was hoping to see more films, and I think what happened is incredible. And I think over the past 25 years, we have a redefinition, and especially when we speak about Palestinian and Arab Jews in the cinema, there is an opening up of the debate, which is why I wanted us, you know, to start with this notion of the absurdity of borders, because the other question is the question of Arab Jews, which also was important to me in the cinema. Again, most cinema at the time, Israeli cinema, did not deal with that question. But you did find Jews from Arab countries cast to the role of the Arab enemy in the most heroic nationalist films. So even a film from 1954, for example, Hill 24 Doesn't Answer, directed actually by a Brit, Thorold Dickinson, has a sequence where there is an evacuation, a 48 evacuation of the old city of Jerusalem by the Jews. It's only that the Arab, the Jordanians are played by Arab Jews who just arrived from diverse Arab countries. And in the shooting of the sequence, the Jews in the film carry the Torah. Only that the Arabs, meaning the Arab Jews who were enacting Arabs, forgot their role as an enemy and they ran to kiss the Torah book. And I thought this was an emblematic moment. The whole scene had to be shot. 600 actors had to. It was a massive sequence. And I thought this is a great story because it embodies the conflictual identity of an Arab Jew, forgetting that he/she is the enemy for that moment. But because of they are Jews for the sake, of course, they are now by now at that point Israeli citizens. But their physiognomy and their accents at the time suggested that they had to play the role of the Arabs. And that practice, by the way, has continued to Hollywood. And in fact, most Hollywood films about the Middle East has Mizrahi actors cast in the role of the Arabs, well-known actors like Yosef Shiloach. And the paradox I pointed out in the postscript, that sometimes Yosef Shiloach, who passed away a few years ago, was, you know, he was part of groups that I was part of, the Oriental Front. He was part of the Toledo meeting in 1989, where Arab Jews met in Toledo, Spain, with Palestinian representatives. And yet, at the same time, he was cast to play and agreed to play the role of terrorist in Hollywood cinema. So there was kind of a schizophrenic existence as an actor. But I think this question of casting and the politics around casting is especially important in the case of Arab Jews and Mizrahim.
I just happen to know the woman who, she's an amazing filmmaker and she's going to be at the MoMA, who did the casting for the Israeli soldiers in Divine Intervention. And she just had a grand old time casting these Israeli macho men, telling them they were not macho enough for the roles and just forcing them to upstage their manhood, you know, the small acts of resistance and revenge. And
but I think it is important because what happened in alternative Israeli cinema and in Palestinian cinema, there has been an interesting experimentation with casting. It starts actually with Michel Chlefi and with a few alternative Israeli films, The Smile of the Lamb, which cast Palestinian to play the role of the Israeli military commanders, like Makram Khoury is one example. Later
very
on,
famous actor.
Yeah, and very famous actors doing so. There is an inversion in terms of casting that calls attention to the dissonances of identity, and also to my mind, and this is coming back to the question of border, it de-essentializes the question of the conflict. You know, when you read in the papers, in the New York Times, the old or in any kind of contemporary show, the millennia conflict between Jews and Arab, you have to be suspicious of a statement of this nature. And that's where, for me, has been important to speak about the place of Jews within the context of Arab countries and Muslim countries, without idealizing, but to question such kind of grand narratives, because they essentialize the idea of Arab versus Jew.
Which is a good, perfect segue for the next segment. So this conflict between the Arab Jews, so I think we will have to talk a bit about Toledo meeting after this clip, but 1492, the tragedy of the fall of Spain and the exodus of Sephardic Jews to North Africa and the Middle East. And Arab Jew was never contained the paradoxes that it did until the establishment of the Zionist state. So in 1991, sure, did not contain the paradox that it did until the establishment of the Zionist state. Yeah.
Or perhaps the establishment of the state of Israel is the beginning of the paradox called Arab Jew. Arab Jew up to that point of the establishment.
So 1991, the Gulf War, Saddam Hussein invades Kuwait, and he, in a very famous incident, at a highly mediatized attack, he fires Scud missiles on Israel, and they fall on the Iraqi neighborhood of Tel Aviv, Ramat Gan. Ella Shohat, Iraqi-Israeli, Iraqi, yeah.
American.
Elia Suleiman, Palestinian, Israeli, Dutch, are in New York. They are watching this incident. And they are, of course, together as fellow Arabs, as fellow Israelis. And Ella was invited to, Ella was asked to write a piece about what it means to be an Israeli of Iraqi origin and watch the Gulf War and the Scuds fall on Ramat Gan from New York by the Village Voice. She writes the piece. The piece gets edited. It's fine. Then suddenly, at the 11th hour,
yeah, exactly.
The piece is not going to be published. She gets a phone call. We're not going to run your piece. In journalistic lingo, it's kill the piece. And in journalistic convention, you get a fee for having written a piece, and it's called a kill fee. We just want to show you the check. It's called Kill Arab Jew.
And Winnie.
So, Elia Suleiman and Ella Shohat are in New York talking. There's a check for killing an Arab Jew.
It was just one of the many kill fees I received. I mean, I think I started a career out of kill fees.
Voila.
It couldn't have been better,
it's
even
like
if I wanted to invent it.
Yeah. So, A few Arab filmmakers were commissioned to make short films on the Gulf War, witnessing the Gulf War. Elia Suleiman directed Homage by an Assassination. It's a diary film of him being in New York, and he is in conversation with Ella Shohat and Bob Stamm, and it is precisely about the contradictions of the diasporic subject.
Just to add, I mean, the film part, the segment that we're going to show you, a specific segment of that piece that I wrote that ended up, a segment from that ended up in the film, but it also highlights the paradoxes of being a Palestinian from Nazareth, while the scuds are also falling in the area of the Galilee, or at least there is a scare all over. But what did not get to be reported in the American media is the very fact that Palestinians in Israel are going through the same anxieties of the fear of scuds as Jewish Israelis. So this is just to give you a background, because we're not showing that segment, we're only showing one particular segment having to do with an Iraqi identity.
Dearly, thanks for the flowers. I finally got through to my family. My brother insisted that nothing serious happened. The scud hit our neighborhood, he joked, because it smelled the amba. As for my relatives in Baghdad, I have no idea. This war has only intensified my schizophrenia. As an Arab Jew, the dilemma of my identity has become almost dizzying. Most of my family was born and raised in Baghdad and now lives in Israel, the US, England, and Iraq. When my grandmother arrived in Israel in the early 50s, she was convinced that the European Jews she encountered who looked, spoke, and ate so differently were actually European Christians. Jewishness for her generation was associated with Middle Easternness. My grandmother, who lives in Israel and still speaks only Arabic, had to be taught to speak of us as Jews and them as Arabs. We Iraqi Jews have lived in Mesopotamia since the Babylonian exile, yet once in Israel we were stripped of our history and forced to repress our nostalgia. We even came to question our own identity. For years, my sister dyed her hair blonde. My uncles and cousins have been arrested and beaten when they were mistaken for Palestinians. The dream of one people reunited in their ancient promised land has led us to abandon our affectionate memories of life before Israel. Yet, 40 years after we were forced to leave Baghdad, my family and I still long for its sights and sounds. My anxiety and pain during a Scud attack on Israel does not cancel out my anguish for the victims of the bombing of Iraq. Yours, Ella.